Welcome to the First United Presbyterian Church. We're glad that each of you is here today. Let us praise God together. Turn with me in your bulletin to the call of worship, and would you read responsively with me? O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Let us worship God. The prayer of praise and adoration. O God, who fashioned the covenant and sealed it with the promise of life everlasting, we praise you for mercies that are boundless and sure. Your ways are just. Your grace is unending. You have sent us the Christ in whom lies your promise that all things will be made new. We come before your throne of grace with assurance that you will meet us as we call on your name. Hear us now as we give our oblations and be pleased with our efforts as we respond to Christ's call. The hymn this morning is number 8, Come Thou Almighty King. Now will you read with me the prayer of confession in your bulletin? Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born to eternal life.
Now and ever shall be, world without end.
peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in peace.
There, all the kids come on up here and we'll see what we've got today. How about that? All right. So we had kind of a holiday yesterday. What was that? What was it? What was it called? Go ahead. St. Patrick's Day. And you guys come on down here. Come on down here. All right. So St. Patrick's Day, and we have these shamrocks. That's part of St. Patrick's Day. And what do we know about St. Patrick? Do we know anything about St. Patrick? What do you know about St. Patrick? Yep, he liked green things. That's right. That's right. He was into green things. And so we've got green shamrocks. But you know, I learned a whole bunch about St. Patrick this week. Where was St. Patrick from? Yeah? Okay, we think he was from Ireland. And do you know what? Where did you think he was from? Yeah, everybody thinks St. Patrick was Irish and lived in Ireland. But you know what? He was a Roman. He was from Britain. He wasn't Irish at all. And when he was 16 years old, he got kidnapped by Irish pirates. Did you know there were Irish pirates back then? Irish pirates. The Irish pirates kidnapped St. Patrick, yeah. Anyway, he got kidnapped and they took him to Ireland for 6 years. And he prayed to God that God would protect him. You know, we've had other people in the Bible who get kidnapped and thrown, like Joseph and other things, and they prayed, and God answered St. Patrick's prayer. By that, then he wasn't St. Patrick, he was just Patrick. But God answered his prayer, and he escaped from the pirates and went back to Britain. And he had promised God that if he was able to be released, he would become a priest. And so St. Patrick went on and became a priest. And after he was a priest, he said, I'm going to go back to Ireland. Now, isn't that strange? He's going to go back where he was a slave for 6 years. But he did. He went back to Ireland, and he preached the gospel of Jesus to the Irish people. And he was one of the individuals who was very responsible for the Irish becoming Christian. And one of the things he did was he used shamrocks to represent God, represent the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, the triune God that we all worship. And he helped them to understand, but it was St. Patrick's love for the people that had enslaved him that let him go back and do this good thing. So I've got shamrocks for everybody in here. You guys can take a shamrock out of there, or two or three, whatever you want. And you can take some and pass them out. All right, you got to get one too down there on the end. All right. Yeah. Yeah. You're part Irish, see? And it's wonderful that God led him to help the Irish people. Isn't that neat? All right. All right, so next time when you see the shamrock, think of St. Patrick and the wonderful blessing that he gave the Irish people even after he had come out of slavery. Let's say a prayer. Jesus, thank you so much for love that we can have even when we're in the midst of things that are not good and that seem awful to us. Thank you for loving us and keeping us in your care. In Jesus' name, amen. All right.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus, my and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest grace. Please be seated. First scripture text today comes from Jeremiah chapter 31, starting at verse 31. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them up out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sins no more. Our New Testament lesson comes from Hebrews chapter 5, starting at verse 5. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, you are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, starting at verse 20. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The crowd answered him, we have heard from the law that the Messiah remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Last week when I was uploading our worship service to our webpage, which connects to the church's YouTube account, when I first logged on to YouTube, they have those suggestions of videos for you on the side. We don't have anything to do with that. That's, of course, YouTube. But one of the suggestions as I looked was an old skit from Saturday Night Live. It was one that I knew. And we've all heard the phrase, Debbie Downer. And of course, that is someone who, no matter how good things are going, no matter how wonderful things are, they have a tendency to suck the fun out of life, the happiness and the joy. They're always being negative. Well, there was a certain actress on Saturday Night Live probably about 20 years ago who decided to embody that in a character, strangely enough, called Debbie Downer. And so these were skits where no matter how wonderful things were going around her, she would always bring people down, make them sad, talk about depressing things. She did it so well, these skits became so popular that she started getting recognized on the street. And I remember watching an interviewer who was talking to her about this, and the interviewer asked her, "So when people meet you on the street, do they ask you to do the character of Debbie Downer?" Now that's a good question, because if you play a character actor or actress that people like, when they meet you in life, they're constantly asking you to do the character. But she said no. Nobody asks her to do the Debbie Downer character. She said, in fact, what they do is everyone wants to tell her who the Debbie Downer is in their life, whether it's their mother or their cousin or their sister or whether it's a boss. She says they're always telling you who the Debbie Downer is. And she says it seems like everybody has a Debbie Downer in their life. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus appears to be one of the biggest Debbie Downers that has ever lived. In our gospel lesson today, there are some Greeks that want to come meet Jesus. Why not? They've heard that he teaches and preaches like no other, that he has wisdom beyond measure, and that he does miracles that people can hardly believe. They want to see Jesus. So they talk to Philip because they live in the same area. And so Philip then goes and talks to Andrew. And Andrew and Philip think this is a good idea. Jesus needs to broaden his appeal a little bit. So they bring this request to Jesus. There are some Greeks who want to see you. And Jesus says, now the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. And he goes on and says, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. The one who loves his life in this world will lose it. And the one who hates his life in this world will gain it for eternal life. The one who follows me must serve. And the one who serves me, the Father will honor. These Greeks are excited about meeting Jesus. And the apostles, Philip and Andrew, are excited about widening Jesus' appeal a little bit. And what has Jesus done? He's thrown cold water on this whole situation. He's talking about all these negative things. He's talking about all these down things. He's talking about dying. He's talking about other people dying. He's talking about suffering. He's talking about all sorts of things that just had to bring Philip and Andrew in their excitement down. And of course, had to bring the excitement of those Greeks down who wanted to meet Jesus. But Jesus is not done being Debbie Downer in our gospel lesson. Then he goes on to say, my soul is now troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? He says, no, for this reason I came to this hour. And he says, Father, glorify your name. And the Father says in answer, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. And the crowd's excited. They are fired up. They know something important has just happened. Some of them talk about the thunder that's answering him. Others say, no, it was an angel who talked to them. But everyone in the crowd is fired up. They know that this must be a sign of the Messiah. They know the Messiah is here. And he's going to ride into Jerusalem, and he's going to start the good days flowing. They're excited. They're thrilled. They couldn't be more enthusiastic. And Jesus tells them, this voice came not for me, but it came for you. And he tells them that he is going to be lifted up from the earth. And when he is, he will draw all people to himself. Again, Jesus throws a lot of cold water on the crowd at this point. They're enthusiastic. They're excited. They're ready to proclaim him to be the Messiah. They're ready to follow him into Jerusalem. And he's talking about dying. This just confuses them. And they say, well, we've read in the law that the Messiah must remain forever. How can you talk about dying? Who is this Son of Man you're talking about? Jesus has brought the entire crowd down. Jesus has been one big Debbie Downer in our entire gospel lesson today. Why was he such a Debbie Downer? In our Old Testament lesson today from Jeremiah, God speaking to the prophet Jeremiah tells the people that God is going to make a new covenant with God's people. And it's not going to be like the old covenant where he brought them out of Egypt and they wandered through the wilderness before they got to the promised land, a covenant that they broke continually, God says. No, he says, in this time, I'm going to make a covenant with them so that the laws and the commandments, they're not going to be written on stone tablets outside of a person, but I'm going to write them on their hearts, their minds, and indeed their very souls. And I will be their God, and they will be my people. God, speaking to the prophet Jeremiah, tells them that he has something even more wonderful and incredible in store for the people than the covenant they already had. Getting back to our gospel lesson today, why was Jesus such a Debbie Downer? Why did he bring Philip and Andrew down and the Greeks down and the whole crowd down when they were so excited? They were ready to be so happy. They were ready to proclaim him to be the Messiah. Now, the reason that Jesus was the Debbie Downer in our gospel lesson is because he had a message that he tried to get across. He tried to get it across to the apostles and the disciples and the followers and the crowds and anyone who would listen. He tried again and again, and he said it in many different ways, through many different parables, many different figures of speeches. He tried again and again to get across one central point. And yet every time he tried to get that point across, nobody seemed to listen. Whether it was apostles, disciples, the followers, the crowd, nobody seemed to listen. And what was that central message that Jesus was constantly trying to tell people? He was trying to tell them what the meaning of life was. He was constantly trying to tell them what the purpose of life really is, except they didn't want to listen to it. Time and time again, Jesus told them what the secret, what the meaning, what the purpose of life is. And what did Jesus say that was? Jesus told us that the meaning, the purpose, the secret of this life, it is a training ground. It is a training ground where we prepare for something greater after this life. Jesus constantly was telling people, if you're trying to find your happily ever after here and now, you're not going to find it. If you're constantly trying to make this the end, it's not going to work very well for you. This is what Jesus is saying in our gospel lesson today. He talks about the grain of wheat that must fall to the earth and what? Die. Otherwise, it remains alone. He says, this life is all a training experience for us. Or you can think about it another way. This life is like school, where we're supposed to learn some basic things before we move on, as school is supposed to prepare us to move on. And even if we go back to school, teaching school, we've still gone through that preparation so that we can then become teachers. Or to think of it another way, Jesus is telling us that this life is practice. This is practice for the important game that is to come. Time and time again, Jesus tried to get across to the people that the purpose, the meaning, the secret of this life is it is a training ground for us for that which is even more important and even more special. And this is why Jesus talks about the one who loves his life in this world, the one who has built their life in this world, he says they're going to lose it. Why? Is God simply being vindictive? Well, just as in our scripture text today from Jeremiah, God is preparing the people that what is going on right then, the covenant they have with Moses, is one day going to be replaced with Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And when that comes, the former passes away. In the same way, Jesus tells the people over and over, again and again, everything that we take for granted in this world, everything that we think exists, everything that we think is going to last is going to utterly disappear. It is going to be dissolved. It is going to be burned up in fire. It is going to be obliterated. Jesus says many different ways that it's going to come to nothing. Everything that we take for granted is going to be wiped away. And for those who have built their life in this world, for those who seek their happily ever after in this world, it's going to be lost, Jesus says. The only person who is going to keep their life, Jesus says, is the one who realizes that this is the training ground. This is the practice. This is the school for what is so much more important to come. Jesus goes on to tell us that the training, the schooling, the preparation we have here and now is only a beginning. That there is more to come. There is more transformation. There is more purifying. There is more work that God has for us, even after this life, Jesus tells us. But he tells us the most important thing is to begin here in this training ground, this practice session. It is the important thing to begin here in the school, the lessons we need to learn right here and right now. Of course, that doesn't mean we can't have fun. We all probably had fun in school as we were learning. And if we participated in any sports, you could always have some fun in practice. And in any kind of training, you can usually find some fun along the way. It doesn't mean we can't have fun, but what Jesus wanted us to understand is that the fun that we have in this training ground, the happiness that we have in this training ground, it can never supersede. It can never come before the purpose and the meaning of this life, which is we're here to train. We're here to practice. We're here to learn. And what is it that we're here to train and to learn and to practice? Jesus tells us about that as well. He tells us that as the kingdom of God comes, we want to be found in the kingdom of God. The first steps, of course, are believing in Him and accepting Him as our Savior. But the next step is the process of purification, which is where we're supposed to be training and learning and practicing. And that is the process of trying to act as if we are in the kingdom of God right here, right now. Now, of course, this is a very difficult thing because we're still in this world. But what Jesus says is the practicing and the learning, the training we need to be undergoing is to try to live our lives as He has taught us. We're supposed to try to forgive people. We're supposed to try to love people. We're supposed to try to help people. A lot of times that can be easy. A lot of times that can be fun. Other times, not so much. And that's why Jesus is very clear with us that this training, sometimes it's going to be hard work. Just like any coach is not going to tell players, oh yeah, practice is going to be easy all the time. You're always going to enjoy it. I don't know any coach that would tell their players that. The same thing in school. Maybe. Same thing with teachers in school. You're not going to tell your students, oh, you're always going to have fun here because there's a lot of things you need to learn that maybe not so fun, but they have to be learned if you want to move on. So Jesus was very honest with us. He told us what the purpose of this life was, the meaning of it, the secret of this life. He said, you're here to be training. You're here to be practicing. You are here to be learning. Sure, we can have fun along the way. Sure, we can find enjoyment. But Jesus says, never forget that's the purpose of life. Because what we're training for is eternity. What we're training for is things that last forever and ever and ever. What we're training for is to be part, to be found in that kingdom of God, to become part of the resurrection of the dead, to inherit that eternal and everlasting body that Jesus Christ manifests after He rose from the dead, and He wants to give to each one of us. These are the things we are striving for, the Apostle Paul tells us. And that is why he tells us, just as Jesus did, we are in training here. Jesus does appear to be one big Debbie Downer in our gospel lesson, but that's only because no one would listen. They all wanted the happily ever after to be right there. The apostles wanted the happily ever after to be right there. Jesus was to ride into Jerusalem, set up as king of the world. They were going to be his right-hand man, so they were going to be right there. And of course, the people wanted the happily ever after to be there. He was going to ride in Jerusalem, and he was going to provide a life and a wealth of abundance for all of them. They kept believing the happily ever after was going to be in this life. And Jesus kept telling them, no, that's not what it's all about. That's not the purpose, and that's not the meaning. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and helping us to understand what your plan is for us, what you have in store for us, and what you ask us to do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Any announcements that anyone has? Any prayer requests? Is there somebody? Okay, let's gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are thankful that we can come before you and that we can pray to you. We are thankful that through what you have done for us, you have claimed us as your own. You have opened up the doors so that we may always speak with you and that you are always with us. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us this day with your vision of the world and your vision of reality, with the things that are important to you. And help us to learn through your Spirit those things that are important to you, the priorities that you would have us make in life, so that we may always be found in that time, in that space, and in that place where we are part of what you are doing in the world. We are your servants, spreading the good news, living our lives the way you have called us to live. Lord God, we pray that by your Spirit you will open us to this ministry that you have called each of us to, and being witnesses to not only what you have done, but what you're going to do. We also pray this day, Lord God, for those that we know are going through difficulties and struggles. Pray for Sharon and others who we know are going through difficulties. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication found in your bulletin. Most giving and forgiving God, you provide for our every need. To open our lips to offer you praise, you strengthen our hands to respond to Christ's call. With hearts, hands, and voices renewed by your Spirit, we place now before you our commitment to serve. Use us in ways that will benefit others, and accept what we offer as signs of your faith. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.